Kaylee Jones, and I'm an engineering physics student from Randolph College in Lynchburg, Virginia. This summer I've been working in the Naughton Lab with enhanced microwave reactions, specifically the Bédard reaction, which allows for carbon dioxide emissions to be converted into useful fuel. Is the Bédard reaction. It's also commonly known as the carbon-carbon dioxide reaction, and as the name suggests, carbon dioxide reacts with carbon to create carbon monoxide. And the reason we want to create carbon monoxide is because it can be used to create syngas, which then is easily formed into other useful fuels. The issue with this reaction alone is that carbon dioxide has a very high enthalpy, and what this means is that the reaction itself favors the formation of carbon dioxide. So carbon monoxide doesn't start to be formed until a high temperature has been reached, which is typically at about 700 degrees Celsius under normal thermal heating. However, a research group from Florida State found that with the addition of microwaves, the enthalpy of the reaction dramatically decreased. This allowed for carbon monoxide to start being formed at about 213 degrees Celsius rather than 700. There was also a decrease in the activation energy of the reaction, which increases the reaction rate, allowing for carbon monoxide to be created at a much faster pace. So what exactly have I been working on this summer? William Brockmeyer and his company reached out to Boston College with an idea to commercialize a product that would be able to convert carbon dioxide emissions from power plants directly into usable fuels. Before we could make this a reality, we first have to replicate the Florida State process, then improve the process's efficiency, and finally scale up the process. This is a diagram of the Florida chamber, and it's a relatively simple design. They use an argon purge to purge the system of any contaminants. Then carbon dioxide flows into an outer quartz vessel, which has an inner quartz vessel within it, with carbon located in between two pieces of quartz wool that holds the reactant in place. This whole vessel is within a microwave chamber where it allows the carbon dioxide to react with the carbon. Carbon monoxide is emitted where a sample can be taken and analyzed in a gas chromatograph. This is the Boston College microwave chamber, and it's a bit more complicated, but it follows the same basic process. Carbon dioxide flows in through a mass flow controller, then into the larger quartz vessel, which has the carbon within it. It's reacting inside the microwave chamber. Carbon monoxide flows back out into a second mass flow controller. And here is a vial where a gas sample can be taken by pulling out the two needles. And any exhaust flows through this hose into a fume hood. This is the inner quartz vessel, and it has the two pieces of quartz wool with the carbon in between. And then this rubber stopper acts as a seal that only allows carbon monoxide to flow out into the exhaust gas line. This is the outer quartz vessel, which has the inner quartz vessel within it. It also has the gas seal. and only allows carbon dioxide to float in. So issues to overcome. When adding carbon dioxide to the system, we had an issue with pressurizing the vessel, causing the rubber seal to pop off. So what we needed to do was find a way to clamp the seal onto the vessel. So we used a hose clamp and a metal staple to hold it in place. But we were afraid that since it's now sealed on tight, the pressure would mount up and cause a crack in the quartz. So we created a rough pressure release system. It's connected to the carbon dioxide line, so if there's any back pressure in the vessel, the gas can flow out of this tube. And the way it works is there's a slit in this rubber hosing on the inner side of the curve, which is in the form of beaker's mouth, which is how it's always described when making it. The way the slit itself works is when there's no pressure, it remains closed, but as the pressure increases, it slightly opens, allowing for some of the gas to be released. And if the pressure remains too high, this rubber stopper will shoot off, and that'll release almost all of the stress until either the gas or the valve can be closed off. This is data from some of our first runs. So first we started by taking a carbon dioxide control. We flushed carbon dioxide through the system without carbon for about 20 minutes and took one of those samples. When analyzing the gas chromatograph, we saw that only carbon dioxide was found in the sample, which is what we were expecting, but it was also very good news because that means there were no contaminants, which we thought that we may have an issue with contamination due to the fact that we did have to use plastic tubing. Typically, you want to just use steel piping because it takes out the issue of contaminants, whereas plastic sometimes holds on to remnants of old gases or can also have traces of the atmosphere. And we did have to use plastic tubing because we had the moving part of the vessel itself. So we know that that wasn't a major issue. And this also tells us that there's no major leaks in our system, which is useful to know because when creating the system, we had issues making sure that all of the different intricate parts were completely sealed. So we took a carbon monoxide sample at 50 watts and 100 watts run for 20 minutes each, and we found that there was no carbon monoxide in the sample vial, but there may be two reasons for this. So the first is that the carbon monoxide did not have a chance to diffuse to the sample vial. So if you take a look at the overall chamber, if it will go back. You can see that there's quite a bit of hosing between the vessel itself and the sample chamber, or the sample vial. And so if the gas didn't have time to diffuse to the sample vial, if there was carbon monoxide in the vessel, then it may not show in the sample itself. The other reason is due to a low percent composition of carbon monoxide. Even though the critical temperature was reached for carbon monoxide to start being formed, it may not have created a sufficient amount for the gas chromatograph to read. But a longer reaction time with a larger carbon sample could increase the percent composition, which is some of the next steps we'll take when taking samples. So how do we plan on increasing efficiency of the overall reaction? Aside from microwave radiation, reaction rates can be increased by using pressures, temperatures, new catalysts, reactor configurations, and transient behavior. For the chamber itself to be more efficient, we can power it using alternative power sources. It's currently run on electricity, but it could easily be converted to running on solar energy, or any other form of renewable energy. So, large-scale application. In the United States today, 64% of electricity is converted through coal or natural gas, but it also provides 80% of carbon emissions to the atmosphere, which is about 2.8 billion tons a year, for reference. The process would include directly flowing this emission through a large chamber and convert it directly into carbon monoxide. The carbon monoxide would then be converted into useful fuels, which would be recycled back into the power plant. The idea right now is to run the reaction using carbon graphite as the reactant source, but it could be modified to run on carbon-sourced plastics, which is a heavy pollutant for the ocean. For small-scale application, some houses use natural gas heating, and they have carbon emissions coming out of a vent in the house. So one idea is to create a smaller chamber to connect to the house where emissions would flow into it, run through the reaction, and the carbon monoxide would be contained until it could be retrieved. This would prevent about 649 million tons of carbon dioxide from being emitted into the atmosphere. So what is the ultimate goal? The ultimate goal is to run this industry into the ground. Rather than just relying on the continuous cycle of carbon dioxide emissions creating into fuel, which run back into the power plant, the reaction and product will continue working until renewable sources act as a prominent source of electricity. These are references to the Florida State paper and other background information. And with that, I'd like to acknowledge everyone working on this project. The theory was developed in discussion with Dr. Michael Naughton, as well as Nathan Nesbitt, Dr. Burns, William Brockmeyer, and Richard Wagner, with encouragement by Bonnie Koch. I would also like to thank the REU coordinators, Ken Birch and Laura Ann Lowry, as well as the members of the Naughton Lab. And there was help from Steve Shepard, Dave Courtney, Dahe, and Paul D. And with that, I'll take any questions.
So you mentioned in the troubleshooting, one of the issues why you didn't get any carbon monoxide is that perhaps there wasn't enough time for the carbon monoxide to diffuse into the collection chamber.
Right.
Like, so how long is like enough time? And did you say that because, well, that's a possible caveat, but do you think that's actually a possibility of what could happen?
I do think it is a possibility for what happened because there is a long amount of space for the gas to have to diffuse through before it reached the sample vial. And it was a static reaction, meaning there was a set amount of carbon dioxide in the system. It wasn't continuously flowing. So that would make it harder for the gas to diffuse. And since the reaction was only run for 20 minutes and we were already expecting a small percent composition, that on top of the fact that there was no gas flow didn't really set it up for a positive.
What was the reason for only waiting 20 minutes? Is just it was a first pass attempt, or
right? We were concerned about overpressuring the vessel, so for the first reactions, we used a small carbon source and a small reaction time.
Sorry, I thought I started. You said something about transient behavior. Like, what is that?
Transient behavior is like the electrical system of the microwave. So it would have to do with the microwave chamber itself rather than just the reaction, but that could be modified to see if any differences in how we create microwaves would affect the reaction.
If you were here for another week, what would you do to get beyond that diffusion problem? I don't think you mentioned it. what's the next step?
I would say the next step would be to run a static reaction, taking out the lard. I would say would be to take out this posing and use a different type of sample vessel, something that we could put directly in the chamber. So you would have carbon with carbon dioxide directly in the chamber, run that reaction at a certain power for a certain amount of time, and then you can just directly take the sample to the gas chromatograph. It wouldn't have anywhere to travel.
So the diffusion distance now is some amount. What fraction would the new diffusion distance be compared to the old diffusion distance? Oh, approximately.
I would say that if we used a sample vial as the actual vessel, there would be no need for time to give a diffusion, because it's already contained within the same vessel.
So many orders of magnitude shorter.
Yes.
Any other questions?